Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 15.2 RC, or Release Candidate. This is the final version of the update before it's released to the public. So this is available to developers and public beta testers, and this particular update came in at a very large 5.27 gigabytes. Anytime you go from a beta to a public version, you're going to have to reinstall the entire OS, so it's a pretty large install. Now I have this on the 13 Pro Max, where it was about 5 gigabytes, and it was also about 5 gigabytes on all the devices here, from the iPhone XR, iPhone 11, iPhone 6s Plus, and the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021. As you can see, right after I installed it, it actually has this hello screen. This shows up sometimes when you reinstall an OS. I didn't get this on any other device, but just the iPad. If I log into it, hit continue, give it just a moment. It's now telling me about it, asking if I want to share analytics and more. And that's what it looked like right after it booted up. So along with iOS 15.2 RC, Apple also released iPadOS 15.2 RC, WatchOS 8.3 RC, as well as macOS 12.1 RC. However, they did not yet release tvOS 15.2 RC. Maybe that'll come a little bit later. Now, this particular update is available for developers and public beta testers, like I said, and if you're a beta tester, I would leave the profile installed as there could be another RC. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to settings, then we'll go down to general, then about. You can see the build number is 19C56, and this will be the final build number released to the public as long as they don't find any other major problems wrong with this update. So we'll know that when they release it to the public. Now, as far as new features, Apple did update the modem in the iPhone 13 series phones, hopefully other phones as well, but that should help with things such as switching between 5G and 4G. It improved a lot in beta 4, and hopefully it's completely fixed in this particular update. Now, as far as new physical features, you can see there's quite a few changes here. The first one is to the notification summary. So if we go into notifications, you'll see the summary looks a little bit different. They've rearranged it, made it look a little bit different, and you can go into your different updates here, and you've got a little drop down arrow to go back and forth. So if you tap on the summary, you'll see there's a little arrow there as well. So that's something new in this particular update. Also, let's turn on Do Not Disturb so we don't get any of those coming in. And the next thing has to do with music. So if we go into music and go to our playlists under our library, go into maybe just select any playlist, pull down a little bit, you'll now have a search dialog where you can search your playlist. So maybe you're looking for a specific song. We'll just type Alive here and you'll see it shows up. So you have the ability to search playlists now. It's something that's new. Also, they've added the option for Apple Music voice plans that they talked about at the previous update that they had with their event. So there's a voice plan where you can use just Siri to activate Apple Music. That option is available now if you want to subscribe that way. I subscribe to the unlimited plan and it's for family, so I'm not going to see it, but you'll have that option here. Now with this update, Apple added a feature they talked about with the initial release of iOS 15 when they showed it off last June, and that has to do with privacy. So if we go to our settings, go down to privacy, under privacy at the bottom, we now have app privacy report. This privacy report shows us a visual representation of everything that's been going on our device. So if we go to app network activity, tap on YouTube, you'll see it says who owns the app, and then it gives different IP addresses as well as what it's doing. And you can show all, and it will show all the different things and how many times it's checked for maybe different things it's looking for as far as tracking, what videos you like and more. So it shows that on an app by app basis. You can see that for everything. So it showed, I just went into media the moment ago, and you'll see it says media library 45 seconds ago. And it shows exactly what I did throughout the day. So it says anytime this app accesses your iPhone's media library, it will be recorded here. It's showing you everything that's going on your device in a visual representation. Now, with iOS 15, we also got the option to hide our IP address a little bit better using a new feature called Private Relay. Apple has renamed this a little bit in your Wi-Fi and cellular settings. So if you go into cellular, under your cellular data options, it now says limit IP address tracking. You can turn that on or off, but prior to this, it actually said private relay. So they've just renamed it a little bit. And going along with those private features, one of the other options you get if you have iCloud Plus has to do with hide my email. If you go into email and you create a new email, you'll have an option right from the from option. So let me show you that. We'll go into mail. If we create a new email you'll see it says from. If we tap on from, tap it again, you'll see it says hide my email. Create a random address that forwards to your inbox. So maybe you want to reply to someone, but you don't want them to have your main email address. You'll have the option to do that now with hide my email. Again, you'll need iCloud Plus enabled in order to do that. Again, with the introduction of iOS 15, Apple talked about legacy contacts, and this would be a way for you to easily pass on your information, transfer your account if something was to happen to you and you were to pass away. That's now been added in iOS 15.2. So if you go to settings, tap on your name at the top. Once you've tapped on your name at the top, go to password and security. Under password and security, you can see there's legacy contact. Tap on legacy contact. You can then add a legacy contact, and it says your legacy contact can access and download data from your account after your death. The friends or family members that have added you as their legacy contact will appear here. A legacy contact can access and download data from the owner's account after their death. So it just makes it easier. Prior to this, it was much more difficult to get that information if something was to happen to you. Now it makes it a little bit easier since you're specifying that specific person. With prior versions of iOS, you were always able to hold the top volume button, press the power button, and you would go to your main lock screen, and you'll have the option for emergency SOS. Apple has given us some additional options for this. So let me cancel it. Then we'll log in here. If we go into our settings, under settings, go down to emergency SOS. Under emergency SOS, we now have the option to call with 5 presses or call with hold. So now we have the option to press the power button multiple times to make an emergency call where it would share your location and more. So if we go home, we'll press the side button 5 times, or the power sleep wake button, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And now it's going to count down emergency SOS where it will place a call. We can stop that, of course. And if we need to call, we have that option now. Instead of holding both buttons and then sliding a slider, we can just press the power button. Another feature that Apple talked about more recently is communication safety for children. Now this is not CSAM protection. This is communication safety specifically. So if you have a child 13 years of age or younger, or just a child in general, what it will do is if they receive a message, it uses the neural engine to understand what's in the photo and will blur it out if it thinks there's something inappropriate. And then if this person wants to see it, they can tap on it and it will sort of warn them and say, would you like to contact an adult first, as there could be some maybe inappropriate things here. It's not sending any data to Apple or anyone else. It's just detecting it using the neural engine and then giving them sort of steps to say, maybe you want to contact someone you trust to take a look at this before you do. So it gives that option. It's turned on in there for a child, and it's really more for just kind of warning them. Of course, they can just bypass that. But either way, it could notify someone that actually is a guardian or a parent and then just help them step through that if it's something they want to see. But either way, it's added. Again, it's not CSAM detection. That's been delayed indefinitely right now. In this update, it's just for children. So if you're not a child, maybe 18 years of age and older, you won't even have that enabled. Now with Siri and Search, they've actually expanded guidance in Siri Search and Spotlight to help children and parents stay safe. The same sort of kind of warnings that are there for messages are there for Search as well. Now, if you have an iPhone 13 Pro or 13 Pro Max, there's some new options for your camera. If you go into settings, scroll down until you get to camera. Under camera, scroll down a little bit more. You'll see at the bottom, there's macro control. Macro control now makes it easier to sort of take a macro photo and lock it to that mode. So with your phone, if you have a Pro or Pro Max, this year's model, if we go into photo, maybe get close to another phone, you'll see it switches and there's a new flower icon. So it will auto switch to macro, and then we can toggle that on or off. So if we want to have that on or off, we can do that. And it's now just an easier toggle to enable that within your camera, where before it would auto switch and there was no control. So they've added that. Also, if we go into the TV app, they've updated this as well. So let's find TV here. We'll go over, scroll down to TV. And within the TV app, they've added a new store. So at the bottom, we now have the option for store. So if we go into store, we can purchase movies and TV shows here. Prior to this, you had to go into iTunes. So it looks like they're finally replacing it, and now you can rent or buy movies right from here. So that's been updated. They've also updated CarPlay as well. Now, CarPlay has been a little bit buggy. They should have fixed that also, but they've enhanced city maps in Apple Maps with road details like turn lanes, medians, bike lanes, and pedestrian crosswalks for supported cities. That's updated if you use CarPlay. If not, you probably already had that. Also, they've enhanced a few things for your iPhone and iPad. The first thing has to do with the iPad. Let's take a look at that. On iPad, you could swipe in from a corner to create a quick note or take a screenshot, and this is now customizable for both sides. You can also use your finger to do the same thing. Take a screenshot that way or get rid of it. And if you go into settings, under settings, scroll down until you get to Apple Pencil. Under Apple Pencil, you'll see we have pencil gestures here, where we have left corner swipe and right corner swipe. We now have the option for quick note, screenshot, or off altogether. Again, you can use your finger or the Apple Pencil, and it works the same on either one. So you could have a quick note from the right corner, screenshot from the left corner. So we've got quick notes there now that I've changed it. So that's been updated on iPad only. Find My has been enhanced, and there's not really a setting for this, but Find My has been enhanced to allow it to still find your phone for up to 5 hours when it's in power reserve mode. So maybe your phone's in power reserve, it's very low on battery, it will last up to 5 hours now to help locate that. Stocks gets an update also. It's a minor update, but it's something they've enhanced. So if we go into stocks here, under stocks, what we have is an update to the currency. So if you're using USD, it will show the USD currency, and it will also give you year to date. So there's just a couple extra things where it will show you year to date performance when viewing your charts. So you have those updates in stocks. Within reminders and notes, we've had tags since the introduction of iOS 15. However, with 15.2, you have the option to bulk delete them or rename them. So if you go into your tags, maybe tap on the two tags I have here. I don't use too many of them. Tap on the three dots in the upper right. You'll see we can delete two tags at once. You'll also have the option to rename them if you want to do that. Now, there's quite a few bug fixes in this update as well. The first thing has to do with Siri, where it may not respond while VoiceOver is running and the iPhone is locked. If you use VoiceOver, your accessibility settings, go into VoiceOver if that's on. It wouldn't unlock sometimes when using VoiceOver if you were on the lock screen. So that's no good if you're using that and you need that for accessibility. That's been resolved. Also, they've fixed an issue. If in the camera you're using raw photos, sometimes it could show as overexposed when you were viewing them in a third-party photo editing app. That has been resolved in this update. Also, HomeKit scenes that include a garage door may not run properly from CarPlay if your phone was locked. So if you have a garage door attached in Home and you're using it with CarPlay, now it should work properly. Also, CarPlay was not previously updating the now playing information properly in some apps. That has been resolved as well. Also, video streaming apps might not load content on iPhone 13 models. That has been resolved. Also, in Mail, if you're using Microsoft Exchange, it previously had a problem where calendar events might appear on the wrong day. That has been resolved in this update. Now, there is a known issue that still remains, which is kind of an odd one that's been there throughout the betas, and that has to do with Apple Music and if you're streaming music. Streaming music may cause an issue where the CPU could be used quite a bit, the phone could get a little bit warm, and in turn have a lot of battery drain. That's something that's known if you're streaming music within the Apple Music app. Otherwise, that should be working properly and it shouldn't cause a problem. So download your music if that's a problem for you. There's also security updates in this update. However, Apple does not publish those typically until the update is released to the public. So that will show up usually the day it's released. And for those of you wondering when it will release to the public, based on last year, it released on the 14th of December with iOS 14.3. This year, I would expect it on the 13th or 14th. Last year, the 14th was a Monday. They released it then. We could see it in a week or so from now based on what they did last year. They've been releasing the same sort of update schedule that they had last year with this final update. Apple takes a break at the end of December for the holidays and Christmas, and so they'll have that time off, so I would expect it next week. And then maybe iOS 15.3 betas in early January. That's typically what Apple does from year to year as far as their release schedule. Now, should you install iOS 15.2 RC? And if you're on the beta program, absolutely, you want to do that and just make sure it's working well for you. Everything should be working. There are still some issues for some people. My Smart Lock app is still not working. It crashes, unfortunately. So if you're using the Google Smart Lock app, that could crash when it goes and switches to Bluetooth. That's a bit of a pain, but they need to update that app as well, as it's 6 months old. As far as battery is concerned, battery has been okay on these betas for me. Now, it will take a few days to know what the actual battery is like, as it needs to sort of finish doing background processes. But if we take a look at my battery health, it's at 100%. I've been using Beta 4 for a few days here, and you'll see my battery life yesterday was 3 hours and 26 minutes of screen on time, 6 hours and 39 minutes of screen off time, and I use 50% of my battery. That's not terribly great battery life, but it's okay depending on how much you're streaming in the background. You'll see I used FaceTime a lot, which will drain your battery a lot faster. So typically about 10 to 14 hours for most people, I would expect the final version to be a little bit better and bring it right back to where it was when it first released. As far as performance so far has been pretty good. I typically measure that on the iPhone 6S Plus, since this is the oldest supported devices, or one of those. If we go into music, I typically use this test to see if it's smooth, and this is definitely smoother going in than it was with Beta 4. So much smoother as far as that part goes. And then I typically open Minecraft, load a map here or a world just to see how it goes. And with the latest update of Minecraft, it is a little bit slower and choppier than it was with the previous version, but frame rates seem much better than they were with Beta 4 with RC. So this seems much better than it was with the previous version with Beta 4. So that's a good sign. Also, I did run benchmarks, so let's take a look at those. From left to right, I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, followed by the iPhone 6S Plus, then the iPhone 11, then the iPhone 13 Pro Max. And so if your scores are similar to these or better, that's a great sign. Again, these are not 100% as far as how performance will be, but just give you a general idea. And so that's everything in iOS 15.2. Of course, I would expect the final release to have the same feature set and no additional features until maybe early next year with iOS 15.3. If you've found anything else though in iOS 15.2 RC, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.